Mother Clark, I said Sunday morning, this morning, I said, just look down your road. And the majority of the people on your road don't look like what they've been through. Look at your table. Somebody in every one of these tables can testify, if it had not been for the Lord. Clinkscales, I see you. If it had not been for the Lord, I see you. Sister Debbie, I see you. If it had not been for the Lord, I see you. If it had not been for the Lord, this room would be empty. But God, who was rich. Okay, I didn't get everything wrong. Y'all sit down. Don't start with me. Listen, the Holy Ghost came in this morning. Was predicated on your praise. I see some of y'all say, I'm getting moved. I see that you don't even look like you want to praise the Lord for me. I'm going to praise the Lord for me and for you. And I believe we're going to continue to praise the Lord until Sister Brenda come home. Listen, the Lord has delivered her out of a coma. Listen, I'm not. It's so good to see Pastor Clinkscale. Pastor Clinkscale, Crown of Life Ministry. He there, he walked around to see a family. Listen, he got a testimony all of his own. I tell you what, this young family, I don't know what it is. You talk about hard times and sickness, ask us. My God. Listen, I certainly thank God for being here. Let me do what I'm supposed to do. Giving honor to the Lord and to Christ who is our life. Amen. We certainly do honor everybody that is here. I don't want to start naming everybody. Aunt Maxine, because you know I had a stroke. Good to see my Uncle Bobby here tonight. Listen, we honor everybody here tonight. I don't want to start calling names all to the preachers, to the ministers, and especially to this McBryde family. Come on, let's show them some love. Elder McBryde, Sister Rhonda, BJ, and Gary. Amen. They're here somewhere. Amen. They're supposed to be at the head table so everybody can see them. Amen. And Deaconess Missionary, Brenda McBryde. Everybody just wave and say, hey, Brenda, hey. Oh, we see you. We see you. We here. We got you. We got you. Ain't it good to know that whenever you're going through, that you got somebody on this side pulling for you? I see your mother coming. I can just go around. We even got to have a program. We can just have testimonies of how the Lord has delivered us over this past year and brought us to this place to where we are. Listen, I'm here to introduce. We won't have church. We just gonna, by the way, we just gonna keep on having church. Everybody, we just gonna keep having church like we have been having. Amen. I'm here to introduce the mistress of ceremony. Everybody knows her. Amen. And everybody loves Missionary Candy Young Sanders. Her name is anonymous around these parts and around the world. And I am proud to call her my big sister. Amen. I am glad to call her my big sister. Amen. We certainly thank God for her. Whenever we asked her to be the mistress of ceremony, she said absolutely. And so without further ado, I want you to clap your hands and thank God for missionary Candy Young Sanders. Let's say amen for her.
God bless you. God bless you. Thank God for being here. As he said, you can tell that we had a time on this morning. Our voices are still struggling. But when the Lord has done something for you, like he said, the testimonies are in the room. Just look across your room. And when you know that our God is a healer, he is a deliverer, our God can do what no one else can. And he did that in the face of not only Sister Brenda McBryde, but as my cousin, we call him Bunky, walks to the table. The testimonies from this room are unbelievable. But God. But God. But God. I don't know if we're going to go there, but he's here. He's in the room. There's healing in the room. There's deliverance in the room. God is here. And he's here because we have invoked his presence. So we thank each and every one of you. And we're going to move right along with the service. But if you feel it in your hands, you got clapping in your hands, stomping in your feet, a hallelujah on your tongue. We're saying just release it to the glory and honor of our God. Because he is truly an awesome God. First up, we talked about the entrance of the family, the various family members who are here. Uncle John mentioned most of them that were here, Brother B.J. McBryde, Brother Garen Ross, Rhonda McBryde, her husband Brian, and the father, the chief of the household, Elder Ronald McBryde. God bless you, and we thank God for each and every one of you. And of course, to the honoree who was watching, God bless you, Brenda. We love you. We love you. And we thank God for the anointing and the calling on your lives. God bless you. Next up, we're going to have reflections. And I'm sorry, we skipped our praise dancers, and I know they're ready. So at this particular time, we're going to ask our praise dancers if they would come forward. I'm sorry, our praise team. Is our praise team coming forward? And after our praise team, we're going to have reflections from various family members. The host family is going to respond at the end of the program. So they will have words at the end after the preaching. And I believe that Rhonda said she will be sharing words from her mother as well. So at the end, the McBryde family will share their reflections. But at this time, we're going to ask the praise team to come forward with a selection. And then we're going to move on from there to have some reflections from various family members. God bless you.
Up on your feet as we praise and worship our God. Hallelujah. He's worthy of all the praise and all the glory and all the honor. Hallelujah.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Bless your name, oh God. Hallelujah. Come on, let's praise and worship our God. Hallelujah. He's worthy. Come on, let's put our hands together. Hallelujah. He's worthy of all the praise and all the glory and all the honor. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Bless your holy name. Hallelujah. Bless your name, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah, yes, Jesus. Yes. Come on, let's put our hands together. Hallelujah, Jesus.
Thank you.
congratulations. We thank God for Jonathan being with us. He truly loves the McBryde family. We thank that we were able to have him in the building and to hear a great selection from him. So thank you, Jonathan, for traveling the distance and to being a part of this. At this particular time, we're going to ask that you come in this order. At Family Reflections, we're asking you to have 2 minutes. We're starting with the second eldest, Sister Carolyn McBryde. After her, there will be following Bernita, Bernita Kersey. And following her, we're going to ask Aunt Maxine if she would come up and also share some reflections for Brenda at this particular time. Carolyn, God bless you.
Reason to fear. I have none at all. After I have been through, I said, Lord, I ain't got no reason. Man, this year has been a year of something. I'm telling you. But you know what? I thank God. I thank God. I thank God for him. Because you know what? I had to put my trust. I couldn't do it. I could not do it. I thank God for my sister, Brenda McBryde. She knows I love her. I call her every day. I do not let the day go by without talking to my sister. And it's, if it ain't nothing but, okay, sister, I can sit on the phone and she sleep, but I got her. I got her. When she's on the phone asleep, I got her. That is my sister. My grandmother always told me the one who's close to you is the one that was raised beside you. And I never knew that. I said, okay, that's why me and Sister Brenda is close. But I thank God for her. I tell you, saints, when we was going to see her every weekend, and there was enough of us that some can go this weekend, some can go next weekend, and we were traveling up to Cleveland Clinic, and when I saw her for the first time in that bed, and you could not see her because of all the stuff that they had on her, and I looked at her and I said, Lord, you are amazing. Because you know what? I knew he was going to bring her out. I had no doubt. I had no doubt in my mind. I knew he was going to bring my sister out. And I said, Lord, I had no doubt that you're going to bring my sister out. But like I said, we went up, you know, we took turns. One went this weekend, one went the next weekend. That's how my mom had all these kids. And that's what she'd be telling us. That's why I had all 9 of y'all. But I thank God because it just wasn't on one person. But I thank God for my sister. And I tell you what, when she went into that coma, and she was in the coma, and I said, and every time I go up to her, I would just sing to her. And the song that I would sing to her was, 'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus. I said, all we're going to do is trust in Jesus. And she was there, and I think one time I was singing to her, and her eyes opened, but they shut back right away. And I said, Lord, you know what? You just giving me a little inkling of what's going to happen. Because I knew it was going to happen. And you were just giving me a little inkling of what was going to happen. But I thank God for my sister. And it was in April she called, and her number came up on my phone, and I said, oh, it must be one of her kids calling. And I looked at the number and I said, no, that's Brenda's number. And I said, maybe one of the kids had her phone. And I answered her phone and she said, sister! Higher, higher, higher! She said, sister! I said, sister! And I was so happy. I said, oh my goodness, my sister is talking to me. And let me tell you, when God does something, he is going to do it right. When she started talking, she was in her right mind. She wasn't just mumbling. She said, sister, how you doing? I said, sister, how are you doing? But I thank God, I thank God, I thank God. That's one thing my mom raised us, and that, you know what? That is your sister. No matter what happened in this world, no matter who's against each other, that is your sister. And you treat her as your sister. sister. But I love you, sister. You know that. And you know, I just brought her a pork chop and took her to her to the hospital. I didn't know what her diet was. She said she wanted a pork chop, so I fried her a pork chop and took it to her and some watermelon. That's my sister. But I thank God. I ask you all to keep her in your prayers and pray much for me. Hi, my chicken. I'm so glad to be here for your occasion. And you know I'm going to get up there to see you before I leave out tomorrow morning, but I would not have missed this for anything. If anybody knows me, you know me and Brenda were like this. They called us Lucy and Ethel, Vern and Shirley, and we had the hijinks to go with them. I would tell y'all some of the stuff, but I don't know if the statute of limitations has ended yet. I don't want to get arrested. But Brenda and I had some stuff. But since I only got 2 minutes, I'll just cut to the chase. Brenda has always been an inspiration. Brenda used to always know everything. And I'm like, how do you know so much? And Brenda told me, she says, because I read. Brenda inspired me to start reading. And so we were always sharing information with one another. So we knew what we could get arrested for and what we couldn't get arrested for, right, girl? So anyway, she made me start reading. And then we started sewing, and we would share ideas with one another. And it wasn't so that we wanted to just keep that craft ourselves. She would inspire other people. She could take, you know, I had heard she was taking a young girl, showing them how to do things. You know, she was doing fashion, hankies and hats. I was doing quilts and aprons, and we were just sharing ideas. But you know, I just think about all the things that we went through growing up. We, you know, boyfriends, you know, phone pranks on the phone on Sunday afternoons, and you know, going around with the CV, driving up and downtown, doing stuff. But Brenda was my cousin. She was my Moon Moon Ace Coon cousin. That's what we called each other. And I just thank God for her. I was home last July. She had just come home from the hospital, and I had asked Mommy, can I come see you? And she said, of course, she would love to see you. And I walked in and I saw her and she just cried and I said, don't cry, because I don't want to cry. I said, I am just so happy and thankful for you. We have been praying, I had our church praying. And you know, God is just so good. We have all had our stuff to go through. But I had told people at my church, I said, y'all gonna get tired of me saying this, but I can only tell you what I know. You have got to trust God. I don't know how you go through life and you don't trust God. How do you go through life without God? And I said, I look at everything he has done in my life, in my family's life. I look at Aunt Emma and I said, Aunt Emma, you are a walking miracle. You are a miracle. That's the latest miracle. When I saw my cousin after her being in a coma for so long, I said, Brenda, God is going to bring you out. You know what Grandma taught us. You know what Grandma Ross taught us. Your mother, your dad. We've had nothing but proper training. And I tell people now, you have got to trust God. I don't know how you make it in life without him. So I just want to say, Brenda, I know my time is up, but Brenda, you just wait on the Lord, girl. Be of good courage. He will strengthen your heart. Wait, I say, on the Lord. Love you, chicken.
And as the old song says, I'm going to trust in the Lord until I die. And we used to laugh about that from Gertie, your mother. She would always say, her cousin would say, as the old song say, and I'm saying it now, as the old song say, I've got to trust God. I thank God for you, Brenda. I love you, sweetheart. I miss you. And I had a chance to go visit her. My niece Stevie came and got me one morning, drove me up to Cleveland, and I cried and I cried because I wanted to see her so bad. But you know what? When I look at Brenda, I don't doubt God for nothing. I don't doubt God for nothing because I know what God did for her. I thank God for the time that we spend together. We were always together. I love the McBryde family, the boys, the girl, and my newest nephew, Brian. I just love them all, Deacon, Elder McBryde. And I thank God for you for taking such good care of my niece, because the care is phenomenal. There hasn't been a time when I went to see her and she was all dirty and messed up. It's always, she always looks so pretty, because Brenda liked to look pretty. And Brenda, you're still pretty. And I thank God for you. Her and I would talk about each other, because we both were freezing cold. And I would go out and find stuff for us to wear to keep us warm, because I had lost a lot of weight and she did too. And I was trying to keep warm. I just couldn't keep warm and she couldn't either. So we shared our warmness together. But Brenda, you're gonna get warm. I finally was able to sweat, and I thank God for that. Because I haven't sweat in over 2 years. And your body needs to sweat. And I thank God the other day. I sweat so, I was in the bathroom praising God so, because I was sweating. But Brenda, I'm trusting God for you too. Because you're gonna be home real soon. You're gonna be home, and we're gonna be sitting down out there under that tree again, like we did the last time before you went to the hospital. We were sitting under the tree talking about the goodness of the Lord. Brenda, I love you. I could tell more, but I'm just so proud of you, and I'm so happy for you and your children. And I just thank God for you, because I'm going to trust in him until I die. Thank you.
So I'm gonna put a praise on me. Come on.
Continue to develop, get better and better each day. And when I tell you, you think about how they prayed for you. And then now it's your turn to pray for them. And it makes me think about the McBryde family, because they had to pray her through. Oh yeah, we were all there. We were all a part of it. But sometimes God puts you on the other side of it. I have seen this family grow spiritually in a way that I could never imagine. I would talk to Garen, and Garen would encourage me about how his mother was doing. I said, Lord, I thank you for the growth. Sometimes we go through so we can get stronger. Sometimes we go through so we can grow up. I said, Lord, why'd you take my father? He said, because I had 9 more behind him. He said, I got nine more who can do the work that he was doing. And you never would do it if he wasn't gone. So he said, it's time for y'all to do some work. So I thank God because he said, there's nine more. And I thank God for the ministry. I thank God for the love. I thank God for who he is. I'm a behave. I'm like my brother. You know, when God has taken you through, and all you could do is just look up and say, God, I thank you. There was a song that has been in my spirit for 2 weeks. And the song is, Lord, you've been good. You've been so good. Lord, you've been good. You've been better. I can't praise you enough. I owe you my life. I can't praise you enough. Even if my trial comes, you can think about that. So good. Church reflections. We're looking at various churches. Miss Gwyneth Jones, we're asking you if you would come on up and represent your church. I see Pastor Clinton from Buford here from Christ Temple Church of God in Christ. We're going to ask if you would come on up and say a word to your lovely, beautiful wife if she could. And so we're also asking our Uncle Bobby if you would come up as just a family, a friend, and Mother Clark. We're going to ask if you all could come up and have a few minutes of reflections for Deaconess Brenda McBryde. God bless you.
I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. Truly, it is good to be here on this occasion and celebrate one of our beloved sisters in the Lord who has been great for him and in our eyes. You know, when you have somebody that is pleasing God, then it also I can say it about Sister McBryde that she has been pleasing. She is definitely one of our favorites. We won't go further than that.
And we don't want to offend any of the young family because everybody's precious. all nine. So I'm here to sweep a little bit around that word. But I have to be honest. When Elder Buford married me and brought me here, the person I fell in love with was Brenda McBryde. The heart that she had, the compassion, the love, the sincerity, and the authenticity. And I told her, I said, Sister Brenda, I'd like you to be close to me. And she said, well, I'll just be happy to do whatever you ask me to do. And you are just at the top of my list. And one of the main things, though, is you're at the top of the Lord's list. Because that's really what matters. And you look beautiful today. Just beautiful. God has been so good to you. And we rejoice in this. As my husband said, we just are here to celebrate you. You wouldn't have missed it. And I'd like to congratulate you. And so happy that Bible Way and Pastor John Young and Lady Young and all the Young family thought to do this. We need to smell some roses while we're living. So we can enjoy some of what God has here on earth before we go on to glory. And so we are happy to be in this celebration. Good to see you, Elder McBryde, all the McBryde. We love you, Pastor Buford and I, just absolutely love you to some high level. May God bless you. You look beautiful, continue to be healthy. And there is a better and a better and a greater future ahead than there is even now. May God bless you.
As Mother Clark is making her way to the podium, we want to recognize Superintendent Stills, who was with us on today. God bless you. And his wife, Missionary Stills, thank you. God bless you for being here. Pastor Gary Clark, I believe, is also here. We thank God for him. Just want to acknowledge them and just thank them for being a part of the service.
God still works miracles. God still works miracles. God still works miracles. All you got to do is just have faith. Have faith in God. One more time. God still works miracles. Sister Brenda, keep your faith. God still works miracles. Hallelujah. God still works miracles. All you got to do, have faith. Have faith. Woo. Have faith in God.
Praise the Lord. I'm an ocean. Hallelujah. God bless you, Sister Brenda. We're so happy to be here today to let you know we love you. And we're constantly praying for you. This is the Lord's doing. And it's certainly marvelous in our eyes. You are a miracle. And I believe the saints and the people of God have been praying everywhere for you. And the Lord heard our prayers, one of the best one, and gave us a miracle for this day. So we just want to say that we love you, and we continue to hold you up in prayer. Even on the prayer line that I belonged to when you were in Cleveland, we were on the line at 5:30 in the morning praying for you. And one brother on the line from Carolina, you would think he knew you. He was called praying for the McBryde family and the Young family. So we're grateful to be here this day. Even Prince Charles, Elder Clark, made his way out. Yeah. Yeah. Amen. God is good. And Sister Brenda, he loved you and praying for you. He wanted to see BJ so bad. Amen. He did not see BJ since he was a little boy. And we thank God for BJ. We're going to take our seat. It's a little comical thing about it. It's so special. Sister Brenda, you know all about it, Elder McBryde. When baby BJ was just a little boy about this size, little kid. I understand my daughter went outside and BJ was in the van and he said to her, "What's your name?" And Sister Brenda said BJ got kind of sick after then. You know how children get sick. He didn't want her to pray, so he said, "Call Sister Renee." So we've been having that going for many years. A fine, fine young man. So Sister Brenda, Elder Clark wanted to be here today to see BJ. And the end time, McBryde, a young family, we're praying for you because we want you to know that your prayer, your trials is ours and your happiness is ours. We're praying for the family, and Elder Young, we're grateful for him because he broke up the dinner when the life flighted him to Pittsburgh. My husband loved to eat, but when Mother Gertie called and said Elder Young had been life flighted, I turned the stove off and Elder Clark didn't mind. We cried out to the Lord. So we understand some of the things you're dealing with because I declare we've been through some storms in our lives. You know about Sister Renee, it looked like death was sure, but God said live on. So my notion, I have to take my seat because when I think about God, I just get fired up. And me, myself, I'm supposed to have been a miscarriage, but I'm yet here. Hey!
I just thank God for all of you being here, and it's such a proud thing for us to be here also. And Brenda, I'm praying for you, and I'll keep on praying for you. And about 3 weeks ago, I woke up at 4 o'clock in the morning. I was getting ready to go to work, and you know I have a little job. Okay, so I was going to work, and then I could not get up out of bed. I don't know what happened to me. And I finally got myself up after about an hour. And then I prayed again. And then I looked down at my shoes and I was getting dizzy. And so I said, I got to go to work today because I got to pay for that car. And then, furthermore, I went on and I went to work Monday and Tuesday. But Tuesday, I was driving again. And then all of a sudden, I just, there was a couple of fellas riding with me, and they said, "Well, Bob, are you all right?" And I said, "Yeah, but I was sleepy." And so then after a while, I said, "Well, I'm going to pull over and let this other fellow drive." And so then when I come home, thank you, Jesus. When I come home, they send me home about 3 o'clock. And when I come home, my son was waiting on me, and I got sleepy driving again. So he said, "Daddy, what's the matter?" I said, "I don't know, but there's something wrong with me." So anyhow, he took me to the hospital about 6 o'clock. I stayed at that hospital till 9 o'clock, no, till 11 o'clock. They did not find nothing wrong with me. That's what I want to thank God for, because they didn't find a thing wrong with me. And I said, "There's still something wrong with me." All right, he called my PCP, and we went down there on Friday. All right, we went down there on Friday. The PCP had the report from the hospital and all. And the doctor said, "Well, I think you're coming down with something, but I don't know what it is." And so therefore, he said, "Well, you take this cough syrup and take those pills I give you, and after a while, you'll start to feel better." And I thank God I did just what he told me to do. I stayed off of work for about 2 weeks, and then after that, my boss come after me, how do you feel? I said, "Well, I feel pretty good, just lightheaded, that's all." And she said, "Well, you take it easy." And I did. But all the time that God has blessed me, God has blessed me time and time again. And you see, when you have a stroke, you don't know it. Yes, because I had a stroke in 05 and I had a stroke in 06. And when the doctor sent me home, I couldn't remember nothing. Nothing at all. But it's a wonderful thing when you look back over it, how God has blessed you and you're able to remember again all the things that God brought you from. And I praise God for that. Sometimes I get mixed up when I'm talking, but that's all right. God knows what I'm saying. And so therefore, I praise God for God for just being God. And it says in the Bible in Hebrews 13 and 12, praise him with your lips. Whether you feel like it or you don't feel like it, offer up praise to God. And Brenda, look to God. I was telling the people today, look to God. Don't look at the situation. Look at the situation, because situations will have you looking down. But look up. Look up to where your help comes from. My help comes from the Lord, which made heaven and earth. And so therefore, I'm still looking to God. And God got some more stuff for me to go through yet. But I think all the things, and now with the song said, I praise the Lord for all the things I've been through. I still got my joy. Thank you.
Put a praise on it. At this time, before we move forward, we will take an offering. Some of those of you who have brought cards and things of that nature, you may put those in the basket as well. I was asked as I was walking through, so you may place your cards in that basket, and we thank you for your giving. But before we do that, Brenda's godmother is in the house. Ruth Robinson. I hope she doesn't beat me when she gets to the podium, like how she said, no, I don't want to talk. But Sami and Gail told me that they had my back. So Cousin Ruth, could you come on up and just share a few words? And we thank God for you. We know that you're a praying woman, and we know that you were lifting her and the family up in prayer during this time. So at this time, as she makes her way to the podium, we want to thank God for our cousin, Ruth Robinson. If you could give her an applause, so she's asking for the Bible Way Men's Choir. As soon as she completes her words, we would like for you to take the podium or to take a stand, and you are going to give us a selection during the offering.
Right, praise the Lord. Bible Way Men Choir. Listen, y'all ain't ready for what we about to do. Come on, Bible Way Men Choir. Before we sing, I'm gonna call on my district superintendent and district missionary to come and have words while we get our song together.
Amen. Praise God, everybody. I'm gonna turn it over to our hands of our superintendent.
Come on, you can open your mouth and give God the best kind of praise you got. Come on, we thank God for a miracle lady. Y'all ain't talking here. Come on, a miracle lady. Come on, we ought to praise God for a miracle lady. She's a miracle lady. It's an honor and a privilege to be here. I certainly thank God for Sister Superintendent Johnny and all of the pastors and leaders here today. And on behalf of myself and this great district, we know, you know, Elder McBryde, we love you and your family. Me and Big BJ, yes, sir. But we appreciate y'all. We love y'all. We love Sister McBryde. Let me tell y'all something. Can't nobody sing like Sister McBryde. When Sister McBryde opened her mouth, the whole country gonna hear the song. Cause she sings with everything she got. She gives everything she got. And I believe if she gave everything to God, God gonna give her everything back. Do I got a witness in here? Somebody praise God like it's already done. Come on, give him a credit praise like it's already done.
Already done. Thank you, Superintendent, District Missionary. Amen. We ready?
We will sing a song and then we want to go into our offering. Amen. Amen. Come on. This is some of us here. Blessing unto Deaconess Brenda McBryde. Amen. This is really the purpose, the reason we're here. Saints are coming with cards, everything. Amen. We want to be a blessing. We want to sow into her life. Amen. I want you to pray about what to give. Amen. To sow into her life. The things that she has done, I want you to think about it. The songs that she has sung and that have touched in such a way. Amen. Deacon Cersei, he didn't bring in his already. That's all right. Amen. The things in which we have done and how she has blessed our hearts. Amen. I want to be a blessing unto her today. Amen. Everything in this offering is going to Sister McBryde. I want you to dig deep today. Amen. To love and show her love and gratitude and appreciation. And thank God that she's still alive. Amen. She's still alive. And her memory is sharp. I see you, Uncle Azar. I see you. Amen. Uncle Azar want to know if he's having dessert. All right, now what I was saying. Sister Brenda, we love her. Amen. We cannot pay her for the inspiration that she has given unto us as her pastor, to hear her singing in the choir, to hear her leading a song. When you don't feel like preaching, preachers, where y'all at? Pastors, where y'all at? Them Sunday mornings that you just don't feel it, but something about something the choir sing and a song they sing that changes the whole atmosphere. You go from, I don't feel it, to give me the microphone. We certainly thank God. We can't pay her for the legacy that she does, the handiwork, the craftiness. Oh my God, the flowers, the decorations on the inside of the church. What about your wedding whenever she stayed up all night making the dresses? Making the napkins and fluffing stuff and making sure stuff is just right. Amen. Sister Brenda, God has given her a gift and a talent to deal with the intricacies, the things that we look past as men. She looks at it and makes it beautiful. And we want to be a blessing unto her on tonight. Amen. I think Pastor, you know I had trouble thinking. Pastor Clinkscales. Bless you, honey. That's my wife. Amen. God bless Pastor. Amen. I'm putting my gift in. Amen. God loves what kind of a giver. I want everyone to stand. I want everyone to stand. As we do this, not to be seen, but to be blessed by the Lord. If you're writing a check, make it payable to Brenda McBryde, please. If you're writing a check, make it payable right to her. Amen. If you have your, we want you to come now. Come down. Do you have them? Come on. Just very quickly, if you have them. If you already gave them, just say something. All right. Deacon Bowler.
Godbrother, this is for you. And I'm your godbrother. And I'm praying for you. But I'm still trusting in the Lord that you come out of the hospital. God bless you.
Sister Brenda, this is from the Sunday School Department. Everybody who goes to Sunday School, give me a J! J-E-S-U-S! All right, Brenda, we know that's how we're going to get our healing from Jesus. We love you, the Sunday School Department.
God bless you, Sister Brenda. We love you. This is men's department. We're praying for you. It's so special to us, and it's just a joy
see all these people come out and share their love with you today. We're praying for you. God is in control. You're a miracle. That's all I can say is you're a miracle. The men, Bible men love you. We put ours in the basket already. But we're praying for you always. The McBryde family, you know the men always got your back. So God bless you. We love you.
Sister McBryde, we have a presentation from Union Baptist Church and Pastor and First Lady Ruth. They love you and they sent a love token for you. And we also have a presentation from the Pastor's Aid. You are a staunch supporter of the Pastor's Aid, and we praise God for you, for your vision, and I look forward to doing many other things because I know your brain is working overtime like mine. So we're just resting up with you and getting ready for you to come back. I love you. God bless you.
Brenda, I thank God for being here today. We already had a conversation about what's going on. I told you what God told me. I still believe, I have a faith to believe that you're coming back here. We're going to hear that voice from you out in the parking lot. You're walking in the, into, if you're walking into the church, you already be in your singing. I told you, God said it is so. I already gave my gift. I love you so much, and thank you for everything that you've done for me and my family.
Sister Brenda, on behalf of the Women's Department, which you founded all those years ago, we have a token of love. We love you. We appreciate you. And like we learned at TWWC that we used to go to all those years ago, and I will always treasure, we believe because Emmanuel lives, I expect victory every time. God bless you, Deaconess McBryde. We love you.
Amen. Everyone, clap your hands. I believe you. Sister, you got something?
On behalf of the gospel choir, Sister Brenda, you know we got you somewhere in there. You know how the gospel choir we do those things differently. But we thank God for you, sister. I cannot wait till we start singing again after surgery. That's what we did, and the Lord brought us through, and he's continued to bring you through. So hold on. We're going to be on the other side of this. God bless you.
Thank you, sister. And also to Pastor Wolford, sent the gift that is in there. Pastor Larry Wolford sent the gift from Beacon Liberty Street in Meadville. Okay, I think I'm done. Missionary Candy, amen. She's back up, amen. And continue on with the service. Thank you.
God bless you. We thank you for your giving. God will bless you tremendously. If you give a man of God, a woman of God, a glass of water, he is truly going to bless you. So we know that your giving was not in vain. We're going to move right along. We're going to have our friends' reflection at this time. After we finish reflecting with our last friend, we are going to have a presentation from the children's choir. Another thing that Sister Brenda was actively involved with and still involved with the children's choir. So at this time, we're going to ask if Miss Judy Wallace would come on up with a few reflections of her relationship with Sister Brenda. God bless you.
Brenda Paulette, look where you are. I'm so thankful that you're well, Brenda, and I missed our talks, okay? So we need to come back. You go way back to junior high, looking up questionable words in the dictionary, up to the scandalous summer when I saw your mom coming in the doctor's office. Yeah, she's having another baby. That's my son-in-law, and now we're thankful. Look at God. He brought us together from friendship to family. I love you, my dear friend. Call me soon.
One of the things she always says is before there was John and Shannon, there was Judy and Brenda.
Good afternoon, everybody. Brenda and I are childhood friends. I'm talking about little childhood friends when we used to run around in our t-shirts and underclothes playing in mud. It was no problem then because we were little kids and everybody was so innocent. And we were neighbors for years. We went to school together. We played all kinds of things. Me and Brenda just played. We made up our own little games when we played because I lived across the alley from her. So we grew up, as I said, we grew up and we still became friends, high school friends. Brenda sewed, I sewed. What Brenda did, I did. It was just like that. And Maxine Weedy, I thank you all. Maxine Weedy, NAPE, everybody, because they took me in like I was one of theirs. They went to concerts with Andre Crouch and all that. They took me right along with them. They're the family that I never had, but Brenda's the sister that I never had. And Brenda, I love you, girl, because I was on Facebook, and I put something up there, and it said, Brenda McBryde. I said, and I didn't think it was so because I knew Brenda was in the hospital. And I checked back on there, and I said, is this you? And she said, yeah. So we got on the phone. I said, Brenda, when can I see you? And she said, tomorrow, because it was late that day. She said, tomorrow. So I said, okay, I'll be there. So it was a Wednesday. I remember it was a Wednesday. And I went to her house, and I sat there and talked to her. And I was just so happy to see her because I didn't know all what she went through, but I know she went through a lot. And like I said, I thank God. And like I said, Brenda, there ain't nothing but God. And the thing about it, I said, the Lord just wants you to rest. Because look at all the people that you have done something for. Everybody. She's been there for everybody's call. So I said, it's time for God. He just wants you to sit down for a while. No matter what you have to go through, He just wants you to sit down and rest. So it's our turn to take care of you. And you know what? God's going to bring her through this. Brenda's coming through this. I don't care what anybody say. I believe it. I know it. Because I've been through some things, and all I had to do was call Brenda. And she prayed. Because this is a praying family, but Brenda prayed for me. And I thank God. So I'm here now. Like I told you, if you need me, call me. I'll be there. And like I said, God ain't through with you yet, my sister. So hold on, girly, because you are coming back. Amen. Praise God.
Oh,
And come on and clap your hands if you know that the blood still works. Thank you, by the way, children choir. Amen. You gotta have some energy to be with them. Amen. Amen. Let us thank God for our mistress of ceremony, Mistress Candy Young Sanders. Amen. Amen. She running. Amen. She's still running. She don't run. But when you see her driving, she's still running when she drives. Amen. We simply thank God for her, amen, participation in this service. To everyone who participated, amen, and came out and celebrated with us, amen, Sister Brenda's healing, amen, and her comeback. Amen. I'm going to introduce the speaker of the hour. Amen. And he is a blessing unto us. He is a miracle himself. He is a miracle. A miracle. Amen. And we certainly do thank God for the life that God has given unto him. Amen. I want to read this and I want to turn it over to him. And I certainly do thank God for my cousins coming, Marla, Dale, George, and all my little cousins I ain't seen in so long. Y'all done got so big. Lord, have mercy. Oh, my goodness. It's so good seeing you all. Amen. Today, we're getting ready for the Word of God. The most important part of this is God's Word. Pastor Caleb James Clinkscales, Jr. was born and raised in a God-fearing Christian home in East Cleveland, Ohio. His parents, Elder Caleb Clinkscales, Sr., and his mother, Marva Ann Clinkscales, provided him and his sisters, Marla Henderson and Adele Hilliard, with a strict but nurtured home environment. In Pastor Clinkscale's younger years, he observed his father and mother serving in church ministry faithfully. His father served for 35 years as assistant pastor at three local Cleveland area churches, Parker Memorial, Calvary Hill Church, and Williams Temple Church of God in Christ, respectfully. His mother served as secretary to the late Bishop R.S. Fields for many years. Caleb, at an early age, had a gift for writing and won several writing contests. One of his writings was published in the Ebony Junior magazine in the mid-70s. Caleb was educated musically at the Cleveland Music School Settlement and Academy of Music in Cleveland Heights, Ohio. He accepted Christ as his Lord and Savior at the age of 10 and received the gift of the Holy Ghost at the age of 13. A few years later, at the University of Akron, Caleb played football and also served as an officer in the university gospel choir. Some years later, in October of 1992, Caleb joined Williams Temple Church of God in Christ. In 1995, Caleb was appointed president of the music department at the Williams Temple, and he was successful in developing the adult choir and male chorus. And they can sing, y'all, I'm telling you. Lord have mercy. In August of 1999, Caleb accepted his divine calling to the ministry and served faithfully, learning under the tutelage of Bishop Warren Elijah Miller. In June 2000, Minister Caleb J. Clinkscales was married to his lovely wife, Miss Darlene A. Sullen, who served as Bishop Warren E. Miller's secretary for many years. Let me add right here, she is also a district missionary as well. Amen. In July 2002, Minister Clinkscales went before the State Ordination Board of Elders of the Church of God in Christ and was ordained an elder. Elder Clinkscales served faithfully in ministry, yet under the tutelage of Bishop Warren Elijah Miller, and often traveled abroad with him on speaking engagements across the United States. When at home, he kept busy serving as a part-time driver, adjutant, sound technician, percussionist, and Young Men of Valor instructor. Elder Clinkscales also wrote and directed plays and skits performed by the youth of the church. In the summer of 2007, Elder Clinkscales felt a heavy urging from God to begin to work in the vineyard. After much prayer, God gave him a vision and a name taken from Revelations 2:10. Be thou faithful unto death, and I will give thee a crown of life. Elder Clinkscales shared his urging and the vision with his pastor, Bishop Warren Miller, and released him with his blessings to begin working on the Crown of Life Ministries Church. The next month at the Clinkscales home, the Crown of Life Ministry was born. He and his wife opened up their home and began conducting Bible studies. Many souls were inspired, enlightened, and brought to Christ. In fact, he began accepting members to the church right away. January 6, 2008, Crown of Life Ministries held its first public service where two souls were saved and two new members were given the right hand of fellowship. And let us continue to pray for our pastor and the Crown of Life Church family, that we may grow in knowledge and in the favor of our God, our Father, our Heavenly Father. Recently, Elder Clinkscales was appointed the new State Youth Department President of the Ohio West Jurisdiction by Bishop Emmett Neville Sr. Most of all, Pastor Clinkscales is not ashamed of the gospel, and he proudly proclaims that he is saved, sanctified, and filled with the Holy Ghost. He is proud to be a soldier in the army of the Lord. I would that you all would stand on your feet and clap your hands. We thank God for the God servant, the God man, the speaker of the hour, Pastor Caleb Clinkscales Jr., Senior Pastor, Crown of Life Ministry in Cleveland, Ohio. Let's say amen for that to come. First of all, you may be seated. What an honor it is. What a privilege it is to come and speak to you all today. When my wife and I came from Cleveland, which is only an hour, maybe 15, 20 minutes away, I've been through some storms before. There wasn't nothing like the storm that we came through, all the cars on the freeway had stopped. My wife looked at me and she said, aren't you going to stop? But something just told, Holy Ghost just told me, keep pressing. Keep pressing on. You're going to make it. Because I had to get here. I had to get here first and foremost because I wanted to see family and I wanted to see friends and I wanted to be the saints. But I also wanted to be in the presence of the Lord. When we came through the door, I felt the Holy Ghost right then. I felt the power of the Holy Ghost when I came through the door. There's nothing like worshiping with family and worshiping for real. Amen. And I thank God for the privilege. I thank God for Elder Young, my brother, calling upon me. I felt so honored when he called and said the Lord put it on his heart to bring me. The Lord has brought me from a long way. And Sister Brenda, I want you to know that I love you. We love you. My wife and I love you. And I want you to know that we're yet praying for you. God still works miracles. And he's still in the blessing business. And I know he's going to fully restore you. Sometimes in the Bible, there's a couple places in the Bible where Jesus went and he healed, but he healed in stages. I remember one man, he pulled him out of town first, and then he got him to do this, and he got him to do that. He healed him in stages. And then he asked him, he said, what do you see? He said, I see ministries. That ain't right. So he took him again and touched him again. And I'm asking God to continue to touch you. Continue to deliver you. Continue to heal you by his power. I know he can and I know he will. Amen. I've probably been to see you at least four or five, maybe six times while you were in Cleveland Clinic. One of those times really stuck out with me and really meant a lot to me. I came and Brother Garen was there and he was just sitting there praying. And I couldn't do anything, Brenda, you didn't know I was there, but I couldn't do anything but sit down and pray with him. And I think we prayed for hours that God would deliver. Look what God did. There is no secret what God can do. Amen. It's so good to see all of you. I give honor to God, who's the head of my life. He is my life. Let me go through the protocols of the Church of God in Christ. Thank God for, first and foremost, for the pastor of Bible Way, Church of God in Christ. Aren't you all glad for your pastor? What an awesome man of God he is. Elder John and I, me and his relationship have changed over the years. We started off just cousins. And the Lord called him into ministry way before he called me.
But I'm going to tell you something. There's something special about Elder John. There's something really special about him. We have become brothers over time. He's my confidant. I've gone to him about pastoral issues, and he has helped me and prayed for me. When I was sick in the hospital, I opened my eyes, and he's there. And look what God has done for him. I mean, there are so many miracles in this room, I can barely count them. I can barely contain myself when I think about the goodness of Jesus and all that he's done for all of us. I told Elder John a few minutes ago, I said, I know these walls can barely contain themselves. There's so much Holy Ghost in here and so many testimonies in here. I'm sure the walls just want to bust. But God is good, saints. I want to also thank God for Superintendent Tyrone Steeles and his lovely wife. I'm so glad to meet him. I finally met him. I've heard so many good things from him, from Elder John. I thank God for the state supervisor, Dr. Wilma Buford, and her husband, Pastor Buford. And also want to thank God for Supervisor Loretta Clark, Meadows Clark. Thank God for her, and Elder Charles Clark. Amen. And to all the family of God, the body of Christ, and the people of God everywhere, I'm not going to start calling family members' names because I'd be here too long. But I thank God for family. I thank God for those who came with me today from Cleveland, Ohio. I thank God for my sisters and their children and my brother George. Amen. There is a word from the Lord today, and I ask that you pray for me as God gives me what to say to you all. Father God, in the name of Jesus, first and foremost, we thank you. We thank you, God, for this occasion. We thank you, God, for Sister Brenda and all that she represents. We thank you, God, for being the heart and the inspiration of her family. And God, we ask right now, and we declare and decree right now, that she will be fully restored in the mighty name of Jesus. Now, Lord, word these lips of clay and give your servant what to say to your people that may uplift and admonish and edify them. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Brother BJ, I want you to know something. You replaced Candy. I wanted Candy to hear this before she left. You kind of replaced Candy. Candy used to be the cousin I would talk about to people in Cleveland who didn't know her. Candy was an Olympian. She was a track star. She went all over this country and halfway around the world because she was a track star. And I used to tell people all the time, I got a cousin named Candy Young, but I want you to know that you've replaced her. I followed you throughout your NFL career. I watched every preseason game, and I'm asking God to continue to bless you in your pursuit of that. Amen? Amen. Now, I do want to share something with you, and I have a couple of scriptures here, and I'm going to share a word with you. If you would, turn with me to Leviticus. Leviticus, the 11th chapter and the 44th verse. Just that one verse. And we all probably could recite this, but I'm going to ask you also to turn to Romans 12 and 1. A couple of very familiar scriptures. So glad to see my Uncle Bobby.
Amen.
And my Aunt Emma. My mother wanted to be here so bad. I was with her Friday, and I told her, I said, Mom, I'm going to Beaver Falls Sunday. She said, you're going to Beaver Falls for what? I said, well, John wanted me to come and speak for Brenda's appreciation. She was like, oh, I wish I could go. Tell Brenda, I love her, I love her, I love her. Y'all know how she says it, everything agrees. Tell her, I love her, I love her, I love her. Now, you know, we're all family, and sometimes I look and I just get amazed at how we all kind of look alike. A lot of people, when we brought Elder John to Cleveland, a lot of people say, y'all look like brothers. It's amazing how we all look alike. And I look at Brenda, and I see Uncle John, and I see Aunt Gertie, but I also see my mother. When I was a little boy, I probably was 5, 6 years old, and my mother would get up and sing. And I asked her one time, I said, Mom, when you get up and sing, why do you start crying? And why do people start jumping up and running around the church? Why is that? by the time you finish the song, everybody's going crazy. What's going on? And she's like, maybe you'll understand it a little bit better later. And that's one of the main things that reminds me of Brenda. I connect Brenda and Mama with that, because Brenda get up and sing, Lord have mercy. Look out, I don't know who said it, but they sang, Superintendent, you said she sings with everything she's got. And that's just not once, but all the time. Every time I hear Brenda sing, it's the same way. But it's to God be the glory. Amen. Leviticus 11:44 says, for I am the Lord your God. Ye shall therefore sanctify yourselves, and ye shall be holy, for I am holy. Neither shall ye defile yourself with any manner of creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. Romans 12:1 says, I beseech you therefore, brethren, help me with it, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. One of the things I thank God the most for is for my grandmother, Lila, and her, and my grandpa. I never met them, but I thank God for them. Here's why. They introduced our whole family to holiness. Amen. And I'm looking around, for the most part, most of us are still living holy. Now, I want you to know today that I'm just going to, Elder John already preached. When I came, the fire was falling and the manna was falling from heaven when he was up here just going forth. He already preached, but I'm just going to speak to you for a little bit and I'm going to take my seat. But I do want you, I want to give you a friendly reminder. Look at your neighbor and say, a friendly reminder. Friendly reminder. A friendly reminder of the benefits, say with me, benefits, of living holy. Say it again, a friendly reminder of the benefits of living holy. Let me ask you all a question. Do you all still believe that holiness is right? You might ask this side. Do you all still believe that holiness is right? Now, I'm asking this question because in today's times, there are so many different kinds and so many different variations of Christians. There are so many, it'll make your head spin. I just heard on the radio today, coming over here on Kirk Franklin's Serious Gospel Music Station, a song with Snoop Dogg in it. And the song came after it was a song Nicki Minaj was in it. I'm not judging anybody. But they singing gospel and talking about how much they love the Lord. But how they live don't reflect it. But the Word of God tells me, by your fruits you shall know them. And although I can appreciate a big star singing a gospel song, I'm more interested in their soul and how they live in. Amen. But I still believe today that holiness is right. I believe that if you have truly been saved, truly been sanctified, truly been filled with the Holy Ghost, then you will truly do whatever it takes to please God. You will be obedient to His Word. And if His Word says to be holy, for I am holy, then you would embrace that idea and strive for it. Anybody striving for it today? Now, before I go on, let's establish what holiness is. So what is holiness? Holiness means wholeness, with a W, wholeness. To say that God is holy is to refer to the wholeness and the fullness and the beauty and the abundant life that overflows within the Godhead. God lacks nothing. He is unbroken. He is undamaged. He is unfallen. He is completely and completely complete and entire within himself. He is in the invisible one, the holy, self-sufficient, and he is the picture of perfection. It is inevitable that people need to see how we live. We can't draw them unless they really see how we live. Our responsibility is to ensure that they see a life of obedience to God's commandments. Most onlookers will think that such a lifestyle, I'm talking about the lifestyle of holiness, is wrong. Holiness is often misunderstood. Many believers think living holy is like, it's just too hard of a life to live, or too boring. How many times have you heard say, well, you know, I want to get saved, but y'all just can't do nothing. But Jesus came and said, I came that you might have life. More abundant life. I want you to know that if you're caught up in sin, you're in bondage. But if you've been saved and filled with this Holy Spirit, you have life. They recognize the truth that God commands his children. God commands his children. It's a commandment, saints, to be holy. And we want to please him, don't we? But then life gets in the way. Just going to keep it real with you. Life gets in the way sometimes. Others compare themselves to the Christians around them and compare themselves to them, thinking, and then they end up saying, well, I think I'm doing pretty good because I looked at everybody around me and I'm doing a little bit better than them. I'm serving a little bit better than them, so I think I'm doing pretty good. That's the wrong approach. God doesn't call us to pretty good. God doesn't call us to pretty good. His holiness is our standard. Look at your neighbor and say, that's the standard. Jesus died so that we could be holy. He went through all of that trouble so we could be holy. If we belong to Jesus, we are a new creation, a new self, created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. Holiness is for our good and God's glory. Now, to some, this sounds like an overwhelming, daunting, impossible task. And humanly speaking, it is. Y'all hear me? Humanly speaking, it is. But whatever God requires of his children, he also supplies. God requires holiness. And his Spirit provides the power to turn away from sin. God calls us to holiness, and God provides for us everything we need to be holy. Amen. Like I said, this is just a friendly reminder of the benefits of living holy. Now, Jesus gives us a picture of a whole and holy life, unbroken and unsustained by sin. Everything Jesus does is prefaced by holiness. His love is holy, a holy righteousness, a holy joy. Holiness or wholeness is the very definition of abundant life. Jesus said himself, I am come that you may have life and life more abundantly. Now that abundant life that Jesus spoke of is one I want to talk to you about today. It's a life that's filled with the benefits of living holy. Amen. My dad told me something before he died. I went to visit him, and after a while, we sat for a while and we talked, and after a while he told me, he said, Caleb, everything that I prayed and asked God for, he has given to me. Then he went on to say, if you learn how to put your trust in Jesus, he will make everything all right. Now, I thought I understood what he meant then, but it turns out that I really didn't until I had my own experience. So let me tell you a little bit of my story. My story begins about 8 years ago. When I was going through the hiring process of the job, they did a drug screening. And I went to give a urine sample, and the results showed that I had an extreme amount of blood in my urine. And I went to my own doctor, and he saw it, and they sent me to a kidney specialist who ran some more tests and told me that my kidneys were slowly in the process of failing. Now, I went to another doctor and he said, oh yeah, you're in the process. He said, but now I want you to do something. Y'all remember 8 years ago, I was probably 2 times as big as I am now. And he said, to stop the process of your kidneys failing, I want you to go through the process of having bariatric surgery, because that will probably not, it might stop or delay you from going on dialysis. So I want you to go through the process of having the bariatric surgery. So I went through the process. It was a grueling process, but I went through it. And in the fall, in November of 2013, I had bariatric surgery. I had it with the purpose, not of losing weight. I was all right big. I could still get around. I could still play basketball for about 5 minutes. 5 minutes, that was it. I get on the court and get right back off. 5 minutes. Brother McBryde, I could still play football for about 5 minutes. That's all I had. But I went through the process, and I went through the bariatric surgery with the purpose of avoiding dialysis, delaying dialysis. The next day, I was barely out of recovery. My kidneys failed. The next day, my blood was so poisoned that I began to talk crazy out of my head. I don't remember anything. My wife would tell me, I would say, don't let them people kill me. What people? I'm in a hospital. I was singing like crazy. I was singing praises. I was singing praise songs, but I was singing them crazy. I went out of my mind right there in the hospital room. It took the nurses and doctors about 3 or 4 days before they didn't know what to do with me. And then they sent me to intensive care. I slipped into a coma for a week and a half. Didn't know anything. Couldn't hear anything. Some people say they saw a white light. I didn't see nothing. I didn't hear nothing. I was just gone. I was out of it. My wife told me later, there were so many people who called, so many of the saints who came by. I thank God for the saints, y'all. Because the effectual fervent prayer of the righteous, it availeth much. Amen. Amen. So in that week and a half, I was completely out of it. Bishops were coming by and praying for me. Family was coming by and praying for me. I woke up one time and Elder John was standing right there and prayed for me. I came out of that a week and a half later. They told me, we put a breathing tube in you. You pulled the breathing tube out. How many know that's literally impossible to pull a breathing tube out? They put it in you and then they expand it, you know, so it doesn't slide or anything. I pulled the breathing tube out. They put me in restraints where they lock your hands down. I broke through the restraints. But BJ, I was strong then. I ain't strong like that no more. I broke through the restraints. But when I came out of it, I was hooked up through a line that they took through my neck down into my heart. I was hooked up on a dialysis machine. In fact, the dialysis machine woke me up. Now, I'm on dialysis. And a few weeks later, I was at Cleveland Clinic for over a whole month. But a few weeks later, they sent me home and I was on dialysis. The very thing I was trying to avoid. So in my thinking, because I was raised in the church, my mother and father brought me up so holy that in elementary school, I couldn't even go to school assemblies. Forget the prom, because they playing that worldly music and they dancing. You ain't about to be doing that. I grew up almost resenting holiness, because I felt like it was a stranglehold on me. How many remember growing up where you had to be holy? If you wasn't saved, you had to fake it. Because they wasn't having it. You couldn't listen to no R&B in the house. I'm going to tell y'all a secret. I used to go sneak in the car and listen to it. I'm going to tell you the truth. I was raised that way. And so when I got this sickness, I said, okay, I came to myself and said, I got kidney disease and I'm on this dialysis. And because of the way I was taught and because of what I seen in my family, I said, okay, there's a whole lot of folks in my family. Our family is no stranger to sickness. If it ain't heart trouble, it's sugar. If it ain't that, it's something else. Our family is no stranger to heart. I mean, and it's stranger to sickness and disease, but we've all come through it. So I said, well, Lord, if you meant for me to have it, I'm going to endure it like a good soldier. I just wore it. I just owned it. But here's what happened. Over time, and it took about 3.5 years of going every Monday, every Wednesday, every Friday to dialysis. I went to dialysis and they put me on for 4 hours a day. They came back after a month and said, the dialysis we're giving you really don't work that good. Your blood is still being poisoned. We need to raise it to 5 hours. Lord have mercy, another hour. You should see the size of the needles that they put in you every single time. They're huge. I got used to that. I got used to that because I said, I'm gonna endure this. I'm gonna endure this like if God meant for me to have it. I'm a soldier, so I'm gonna take it. I'm gonna live this. But guess what? Over time, it got grueling. It got rough. The devil started messing with my mind. The devil said, see, I got you right where I want you because this is affecting your ministry. It was affecting my home life, It took over everything. And I got tired of being on dialysis. Y'all ever get sick and tired of being sick and tired? I got sick and tired of being sick and tired. Because after I got off dialysis, I would have to come home and go to bed because it wore me out, it made me tired all the time. They said it'd make you irritable. It didn't make me irritable, it just wore me out. And last summer, it came to a boiling point because they told me that the access they put in my arm to draw the blood was slowly starting to not work. And I might have to go in and have another surgery to get an access put in somewhere else. And I just told God, enough is enough. Now listen, and I say this to the glory of God. I got tired. But I didn't take it to the Lord. Because I felt like, Lord, if you meant for me to have this, I'm just going to endure it. I'm just going to wear it. I'm just going to take it. And thank God for the Holy Ghost. The Word of God. The Holy Ghost started bringing the Word of God to my mind. And there was a scripture that every time I thought about it, it would pop up in my head. And every time I would think about the anguish, somebody said, don't focus on the circumstance, focus on God. I was focusing on the circumstance, I'm gonna be honest with you. But every time I did, the Holy Ghost would bring up this word to me. I'll tell you the word, it was John 15:7. He said, if ye abide in me, and my word abide in you, you can ask what you will, and it shall be done. That scripture haunted me. So much so that I said, well, you know what? This must be something God want me to preach. So Elder Young, I started putting the message together. And I was going to challenge everybody at Crown of Life to start asking God for miracles. Because sometimes we don't ask God. What does the word say? You have not because you ask not. I didn't realize at the time I was putting together that message, but the message was for me. And I went through that process. And I stood in front of my church. And I said, I'm preaching this to you all, but I haven't preached it to myself. So I'm going to do this in front of you all. And right there in front of them, I declared. I said, Lord, I'm tired of being on dialysis. It's taken over my whole life. I don't want to go into 2018 on dialysis. I said that in September. I don't want to go into 2018 on dialysis. I don't know how, I don't know when, I don't know what you're going to do, but I'm asking you for a miracle. I said that right in front of all the people. 1 month later, they said, Mr. Clinkscales, we may have a kidney for you. You're number 2 on the list. you're, don't get excited. Don't, you know, don't get ready for it. We just want to prepare you just in case this kidney is yours. Now, we want to match the kidney with your blood. They already had my blood down there at Cleveland Clinic. And if there's a match, and if there's something happens with the number one person, then we'll call you back and let you know this kidney's yours. I hung up the phone with them, and I was on dialysis when they called. I went home and told my wife. But guess what I told my wife? When the lady from the kidney transplant center described the kidney to me, because that's their process, they describe the kidney to you, the donor and everything, and they said, this kidney comes from an 11-year-old little girl who died in a car accident. This is a prime kidney. This is the type of kidney everybody wants, because at 11 years old, they had no time to develop hypertension, no time to develop diabetes, no time to develop any of the venereal diseases or anything. It's a pure kidney. When the lady said it's a pure kidney, the Holy Ghost spoke to me and said, that's yours. I went home and told my wife what the lady said, and I also told my wife, we need to get ready because they're gonna call me and we need to pack a bag because I'm getting ready to have a kidney transplant. A few minutes after I told her that, Cleveland Clinic called and said, how quick can you get down here? Praise God. Praise God. Hallelujah. We packed the bag. We got down. Now, mind you, this is 11 o'clock at night. We packed the bag. We put our dog in his carriage. We left and got down to Cleveland Clinic at midnight. They said, go through admitting, and we'll get you in a room, get you set up, be ready to be up all night because we're going to run tests on you all night. I got down to Cleveland Clinic, went to admitting. The admitting was dark, but nobody down there. Now, I'm going to start telling you, showing you some of the miracles God performed. I called the kidney transplant center and said, y'all told me to come down here, but there ain't nobody down here. We're standing in a dark room admitting everybody's gone. They said, hold on 1 second. They came back to the phone and said, you don't have to be admitted. Your room is already ready. How many of you know that you can go to the hospital and not be admitted? The Lord did it. Amen. That's just one of the miracles. I got up to the floor, I changed, I got into the bed, and they ran tests on me all night. And they said, don't get excited, don't get your hopes up, because if anything shows up on these tests, we will cancel the transplant for your safety. They said, but if everything goes well, at 10 o'clock in the morning, we're gonna wheel you into the operating room and perform that surgery on you. I stayed up all night running test after test. But again, each test, the Holy Ghost kept telling me, it's gonna be all right. At 10 o'clock, at 9:59, I was outside the doors of the operating room. Y'all, I was by myself, but I had my hands lifted up. Because he's a mighty God. I went through the operation. The operation took 5 hours. Came out of the operation, went into recovery, came in recovery, and the doctor came to see me. He's a little Filipino doctor. Little short man. He came in and he said, Caleb, how are you doing? I said, I'm doing as good as can be expected. He said, you had a difficult kidney transplant, but all went well. He said, what was difficult is you've been on dialysis for 3.5 years, and when you have it, because when your kidneys fail, you can't urinate. That's why your blood gets so poisoned. So he said, when I tried to attach your ureter to your bladder had shrunk up so small it was the size of a pea. He said, but I prayed for you. There's another miracle. Out of all of the doctors at Cleveland Clinic, probably hundreds of doctors in Cleveland Clinic, I got the saved one. I couldn't get out of that bed, but if I did, I would have shouted all over that room. He said, a few days later, he said, I don't want you to get upset, but we need the kidney to do three things. We need it to clean the blood, we need it to regulate your urine, and we need it to the blood to flow. He said, it's doing two out of three things. Right now, it's not cleaning your blood that well. He said, normally, here's another miracle. He said, normally, I would put you back on dialysis until that other part kicks in. He said, but we gonna trust God. I said, Dr. Wee, you said what? He said, we gonna trust God. Yes, sir. 2 weeks later, that other third part kicked in. Every week for the next 6 months, I went to Cleveland Clinic for a follow-up appointment. And they do everything by numbers. My blood cleaning number was at like a 13, 14, which is not good. You should be on dialysis when it's that level. But don't you know that when you believe in God, when you fully trust Him, it might take a while, but He works it all out. Each week, I kept going back, and it went from a 13 to a 10, and from a 10 to a 9, and from a 9 to a 7, and from a 7 to a 5. And they said, Mr. Clinkscales, when it gets down to a 1 or a 2, the kidney's functioning at maximum capacity. In December, I registered a 1.9. And when I went last month, they said it's still at 1.9. Now, do you all remember what I said in front of my church? I said, I don't know how, I don't know when, I don't know what they're going to do. But in 2018, I want to go into that year without dialysis. In 2018, I came into that year not on dialysis. And He's blessing me even right now. It's been a long recovery process. I thank God for my wife, how she took care of me. When I first came home from the hospital, I could barely walk. My son had to help me get up the stairs to my room. I was so weak. I'm not used to being weak. I'm used to being a strong one. But I had to adjust. But I said, I'm going to do everything that doctor tells me. I'm going to do everything the Word of God and God tells me. Because I see that when God has His hand in something, you don't have to get involved. Just step aside and let Him have His way. Let Him do it. So I said, I'm going to sit here. I went on disability. I sat there in the house. It killed me because I'm used to working. But I sat there until I started feeling better. I started looking better. My wife said, your skin looks so good now. Dialysis has made me a lot darker. I'm a black brother, but dialysis has made me a lot darker. She said, your color's starting to come back. Look at the goodness of God. Now, that's my story. And I took too much time telling you, but I'll tell it to the glory of God. That's my story. And looking around the room, a lot of you have a story too. The stories are not the same, but the end result is. Jesus brought me out all right. Did He do that? Can somebody help me? Jesus brought me out all right. If you can say that, say it real loud. Jesus brought me out. All right, I've been through the storm. But He brought me out all right. If I could leave you with anything today, it's that there are some benefits to living holy. In fact, all of the promises of God made in this world are meant for you. And they are yours to take advantage of. And I want to encourage you today to start taking advantage of some of God's promises. But keep in mind that a good amount of God's promises are based on one condition. You've got to be obedient to His word. And you've got to be striving for holiness. I'm talking about promises like John 15:7. If ye abide in me and my word abide in you, then you can ask what you will and it shall be done. John 3:16 says that whosoever believeth on him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. I don't want you to miss it. Did you see the condition there? The condition was, whosoever believeth in him shall have everlasting life. You can't earn it, you can't deserve it, but all you got to do is just believe. Promises like Exodus 19:5. Now if you obey me fully and keep my commandments, then out of the nations you will be my treasured possession. Promises like Deuteronomy 11:13-15. So if you faithfully obey the commands I'm giving you today, to love the Lord your God and to serve him with all of your heart and your soul, then I will send rain on your land in the season, both autumn and spring rain, so that you may gather in your grain, new wine and oil. I will provide grass in the field for your cattle, and you will eat and be satisfied. But do you see the condition there? If you faithfully obey my commands. Promises like Psalm 91:9-10. If you make the Most High your dwelling, even the Lord who is my refuge, then no harm will befall you. Praise God. Nor disaster will come to your tent. Promises like Luke 17:6. And the Lord said, if ye had faith as a grain of a mustard seed, you might say unto the sycamore tree, be thou plucked up by the root and be planted into the sea, and it shall obey you. Promises like John 8:51. Jesus said, verily, verily, I say unto you, if a man keep my saying, he shall never see death. Promises like 8:31. What shall we say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? Promises like 2 Chronicles 7:14. Say it with me. If my people, who are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land. But do you see the condition there? If my people, if you've been living holy, if you've been obedient to his word, I want to encourage you today, don't be afraid to ask God to do the impossible for you. I don't care what it is. Ask him believing and not doubting. Because doubting disqualifies you from receiving what God you desire from the Lord. There are several miracles in this place tonight. Right now, just look around you. He's not here, but Minister Eric Cook is a walking miracle. And Maxine is a walking miracle. Pastor Young is a, and that's right, praise God for it. Pastor Young is a miracle. Our honoree today, Brenda, you are a miracle. They didn't earn it. They didn't deserve it. All they did was trust God and live holy. I told you before, there are some benefits to living holy. It ain't just heaven. I look forward to heaven. But I want you to know something. If you live holy, you can have heaven right here on earth. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. This is just a reminder that there are some benefits to living holy. I've got to go, but let me leave you with this. If you embrace holiness and strive for it, not only will you enjoy complete access to all of the promises of God, but you will also live in his favor. Well, what is favor? Favor is the system God uses to reward the obedient. Now there are, I studied it, there are some real theological terms I can put in there, but y'all don't need that. I just broke it down all the way. What is favor? Favor is the system God uses to reward those who are obedient. Favor will get doors open for you that were shut to everybody else. Favor will get you a new car or a new home when your credit isn't worthy enough. Favor will get you jobs that you're not really qualified for. That's favor. Is there a witness in the house? I was thinking about Hezekiah the other day. God showed Hezekiah some favor. Hezekiah heard that he was about to die. You all know the story. And instead of accepting it and preparing himself for death, he went into his room and the Bible said he turned his face to the wall. Then he began to give God his spiritual resume. He said, I'm paraphrasing, he said, wait, God, I have lived upright before you with a pure heart. I'll translate that for you. I've been living holy a long time. And I'm not ready to die yet. God heard his prayer and gave him 15 more years. If Hezekiah did not have that testimony of living holy, he would have probably died. If Sister Brenda didn't have that testimony of living holy, she would have probably died. If Aunt Emma didn't have that testimony of living holy, she probably would have died last week. But look at her, she's here tonight. Praise God. That's favor. Look at your neighbor and say, that's favor. Be encouraged, saints. Keep on living holy. Keep on walking in his favor. Keep on trusting and believing. And put all of your trust in him. There was a man who took his unruly son to Christ. This son was out of control. The devil had his mind. He was doing crazy things. He was doing stuff to hurt other people. He even tried to kill himself. This father loved his son. He couldn't do anything with him. So he took him different places. He took him to the disciples. The disciples couldn't do nothing with him. So he found himself, he had enough in him to take him to Jesus. And when he took him to Jesus, he said, can you help me with this son? Jesus said, all things are possible to them that believe. Now, I believe the man believed because he took him to Jesus. But the man made a very honest statement. He said, I believe, but I've been dealing with this situation so long. He said, I believe, but I doubt if anybody could do anything with it. So help me where I don't believe. That was probably one of the most honest prayers I've ever heard prayed in the Bible. He said, I believe in you. I'm standing here in front of you with my son. But help me where I doubt, because I've been dealing with this a long time. I'm saying this to encourage somebody. You might have been dealing with something for a long time, but I encourage you today to take it to Jesus anyway. And ask the Lord to help you. I want to tell you something about doubt. Doubt will disqualify you from receiving any of God's promises.
That's right.
I had to search myself because I believe God could do anything.
That's right.
I'm a pastor. I believe God for all of my members. There are some members that have been delivered. Some members didn't have jobs. We prayed, and I believe God for them. And I believe God got them jobs. I believe God for healing, and God healed through the effectual fervent prayers of the righteous. But I lacked one thing. I didn't think God would do anything for me. Just gonna be honest with you. Long as I've been walking with the Lord, I had a little bit of doubt. I believe God for everybody else, but I didn't truly believe him for me. I figured if he gave it to me, if he allowed me to have it, I must just endure it. I want you to know that if you've been living holy, you can take it to the Lord and ask him. And I was talking to my wife earlier today, and we were just talking about how God cannot lie. His promises are true. And what he promised you, he will deliver. He will deliver. But there are some prerequisites to that. There are some conditions to that. You got to be obedient to his word. You got to be trying to live holy. And God will give you the desires of your heart. He'll make it all right. Whatever it is, whatever the problem. How many of us got problems? How many of us got situations? I know from experience that church folk don't always take everything to Jesus. But I want to encourage you today. That situation you have, you think is impossible, there's nothing impossible with God. But you got to check yourself, because you're the one taking it to God. And you got to say, Lord, I believe that you will. There's a saying, that's going around. Won't he do it? Yes, he will. Won't he do it?
Yes, he will.
Won't he do it?
Yes, he will.
Won't he open doors?
Yes, he will.
Won't he make ways?
Yes, he will.
Isn't he a healer?
Yes, he will.
Amen. And that's not just for other folk. That's for you too. That's for you and you and you. And some of us in this family who've been dealing with stuff. I'm a witness. I asked God for it and he gave it to me. Amen. Amen. Have you tried Jesus? Have you tried Jesus? Have you tried Jesus? Have you tried Jesus? Have you tried my Jesus? Have you tried Jesus? Have you tried Jesus?
Thank God for Pastor Clinkscales. Man, what a word. Whew. He preaches so I need to run up there and just jump on him or something. Whew, thank you, Jesus. The benefits. Do y'all know that there are benefits of living holy? Amen. And come on, clap your hands one more time. Let me say this. We're going to prepare our hearts very quickly to be a blessing unto the speaker. The gifts back into here. But Pastor Clark, I seen you. I seen you standing. I'm telling you something. I'm telling you something. These pastors have gone through some stuff. When we come to church, we Bible and tell you, I don't preach the same like I used to preach. I preach every sermon like it's my last time I'm ever getting to the podium. After God has delivered you through some stuff and some sicknesses, some near-death experience, you have a double determination that it is for God I live and for God that I die. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Come on, everybody, get a good gift in your hand. We want you to stand to your feet. Amen. Amen. We're going to unleash this McBryde family. Bless them, but we want to bless Pastor Clinkscales. He didn't have to come all this way and bless us the way he did and share the benefits of his testimony. The benefits of living holy. Expect it. Expect your miracle. Father, we thank you. We thank you for the God-man. We thank you for how he poured into us on today. We thank you, God, even for his healing. How you have delivered him and made him whole and is making him whole. God, touch his body, touch his wife, touch his ministry, touch his family, touch his children, touch the grandchildren in the name of Jesus. Now, Lord, bless every gift and every giver, those who have to give and those who have nothing to give. And Lord, do it that right early. In Jesus' name we pray. And we all said amen. Come on, walk right out with your gifts. Come on, walk right out with your gifts. Come on, give us some music. Give us some walking music. amen, and to this offering, amen. We know that God loves a cheerful giver. Amen. Once again, we're coming down to the close of this beautiful service in celebration of Sister Brenda McBryde. Amen. I believe now this is the time to where we're going to unleash the family and to allow them to have words. Amen. Allow them to have words. Sister Ron, I believe, is coming. She has some writings from Sister Brenda McBryde. Amen. And you want to stay and hear the conclusion of the whole matter. We thank you all for coming. We thank you. We thank you. We can't thank you enough. Amen. We want everybody to stand on your feet and clap your hands as we thank God for Sister Brenda McBryde. Amen. And we thank God for her daughter and her son-in-law, Elder McBryde, BJ and Garen. We thank God for them as they come. Amen. Thank you.